which is the first commandment. How am I going to set my affections on Christ, which is risen from the dead? Some of you might remember back when you were first saved. Y'all remember? How it was such a joy in your spirit? How your heart burned? Let me ask you something. Does your heart still burn about the Lord Jesus Christ? You remember the disciples when they walked on the road from Emmaus to Emmaus, and they didn't know that Jesus Christ was walking with them. And they were explaining to him what happened to Jesus, how he was crucified and how he was risen from the third day. And they didn't know who he was. But after when it was revealed to them who he was, they said, "Did not our heart burn within us?" I want to ask you something this morning. When you hear the truths of God's word, when you hear the word explained, when the Holy Spirit comes to your heart and he reveals to you Christ Jesus through the word of God, do you have that tingling still in your heart? Does it still burn in your heart? I tell you how it affects me. I get goosebumps. I really do. When I hear the truths of God's word, when I hear the truths broken down and rightly divided, when I see the glory of God revealed to me through the word of God, I want to tell you what it does. I have goosebumps all over me. When I'm preaching to you sometimes and the Holy Spirit is actually activated and the word is being expounded and the word of God is being revealed to me, I want to tell you what, something happens to me physically. You know, the scripture tells us, and it very plainly it says in Mark chapter 12, verse 30, that we should love the Lord our God with all our heart. Amen. This love should be so full in our heart that we should love him with every bit of our heart. Amen. Not only that, with all our soul. Amen. All our emotions should be loving him. Now, if y'all watched football yesterday, don't raise your hand if you did. But if you watched football yesterday, you saw stadiums full of people who were very anxious. And you could tell that they were loving what they were seeing. What were they doing? They were yelling. Some of them were dressed up in all kind of costumes. Weird stuff. But they were all excited. And all their soul was into those football games. Right? Now listen, we're in trouble if we don't love the Lord the same way. Amen. Now I know a couple good fishermen in here. I'm going to pick on the fishermen today. I love picking on my fishermen. I'm not even going to name their names, but I know two, three of them that are good fishermen. Probably more of you. But when they hang that 8 or 10 pound bass, they get excited. I mean, their souls into it, right, Brother Ken? It's exciting, isn't it? I named him, didn't I? I can pick on deacons. Amen. They pick on me, I'll pick on them. But boy, when you hang that bass, your soul's into that. Amen. And I like to fish too. But that's exciting to pull up a big spot or something, or Opelousas. And probably some of you don't know what an op is, but that's a spotted catfish. And that's my fishing, you know, the old-timey fishing with a pole set. And I love that. Boy, I tell you, it does something to me. My soul gets into it. Mark 12, 30 says, loving with all our heart, all our soul. Not only that, but loving with all our intellect. If you love him with your intellect, you know what you're going to be doing? You're going to be in the house of God studying God's word with fellow believers. Not only are you going to be in the house of God studying all the believers, but you're going to want your children listening to the word of God. You're going to want them taught the word of God. You're going to have them in Bible studies, and you're going to have them on the anointed word of God. Amen. Because the scripture says here in Deuteronomy chapter 6, to not only you get in the word of God, which we just read, but to train up your children also so that when they're old, they won't what? What? Amen. Now think about that just for a minute. This is a command that God, not Danny Perry, if I gave you something, it wouldn't amount to a hill of beans. But this is a command that God gave Moses to train up those children in those ways so they won't depart. Mark, not only we should love him with all our mind, our heart, our soul, but with all our strength. When I think about strength, I think about a weightlifter picking up heavy weights. And I ain't going to tell you how much I can pick up. I used to pick up a lot, but see, now it's diminishing. But I get a mental intellect of strength of a weightlifter just picking up hundreds of pounds of weight or 1,000 pounds of weight, these weightlifters, and they picking them up. And every ounce of their strength is in picking up those weights. Every ounce of your strength should be in loving God. Amen. Loving Christ. Amen. If you're not giving him all your strength, all your mind, all your soul, all your intellect, all your emotions, you're falling short of what God's called you to do. Amen. What are you to set your affections on? You're to set your affections on the Lord Jesus Christ, which saved us. Now, you can't do that if you're not saved this morning. You don't know what I'm talking about. Now, I'm preaching to save people this morning. If you're lost, listen, the Holy Spirit will save you this morning. But I'm preaching to you as Christians this morning. Here's our command, that we to love the Lord our God with all our hearts, and he wants intimate fellowship. He created us in his image so we could communicate with him. Matter of fact, he created us in that image that we could reproduce so we would have more children like his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, God loves his son so much that he wants many children. That's why he told the children of Israel, why he gave the command to Moses, train your children up in the way they should go, because I want them to look like my son, the Lord Jesus, so I can have fellowship with them when they get older. Amen. Now listen, you can train children up and they may go a different way when they get older, but let me tell you something, the word of God that's in their heart will not depart. It'll be like a hound dog barking at them all the times when they're in rebellion against God. That seed will be planted, and you've done your purpose. You've done your will. Amen. That seed is planted, and they cannot get away from it, but they have to be under the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God, or they will have nothing to come back on. And it'll be your fault, because it's your responsibility to have your children honor the Word of God. God commanded us to do that. A lot of our new things is designed for failure because it separates our children from the pure, unadulterated Word of God. We have to get in that order. We should know how to conduct ourselves in the house of God. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 says this, forsake not the assembling of yourselves in the house of God, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Why? So that Word of God can be planted in our hearts. Now listen, y'all want the truth, you want me to get up here and tickle your ears? I have no desire to tickle ears this morning. I have one desire, and that's to preach God's Word. And you didn't come here this morning for me to make you feel good. You come here this morning to worship God and to hear from God. And for God to bless you. Anything else other than that comes short. Psalms 119, 97 and 8 says this, oh, how I love the law. It is my meditation day and night. Matthew 10, verse 37, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. He that taketh up his cross and followeth not me is not worthy of me. You see, we should love the Lord our God more than our fathers, more than our mothers, more than our brothers and sisters. And you might say, well, hey, that's my blood. I love them, and you should. But let me tell you something. When you put God first, you'll love your father and mother right. Amen. When you put God first, you'll love your children right. But if you put them first, you can't love them first. It's idolatry. You have to put God first. Preeminent in your life more than anything on the planet Earth. He has to be worshipped. Anything else will bring idolatry in your life. America's full of idolaters. America idolatrizes religion. America's idolaters when it comes to sports. America's idolaters when it comes to education. America's idolaters when it comes to health. America's idolaters when it comes to family. America worships in America and today, the people of America worship possessions. God's people worship possessions. God's people sometimes have self-love. They love themselves more than they love God. The Bible says that we have to pick up our cross. What does that mean? We have to die daily so Christ can be formed in us. What the Apostle Paul said, he said this, I die daily. You have to die daily so Christ can be formed in you. It's not your way, it's God's way. It's not the way religion orders us. It's the way God wants us to be ordered. The Bible says clearly that we should know how to conduct ourselves in the house of God. We don't need any other new manual. Well, I have my manual right here. Y'all see this? This is God's manual. You want to have the church ordered right? Read the book. Amen. If you want to do your family right, read the book. It's got everything you need right here. Amen. Plus nothing. America's idolatry today when it comes to pleasure. And God knows we are idolaters when it comes to pleasure. As a matter of fact, we love pleasure so much that our youth are being taken away by meth and cocaine and all types of drugs that release dopamine in their brains. Every time they take a hit of meth, they release 1,200 units of dopamine, and they want that pleasure. That's the whole root cause today of America's downfall, is that we our gods have risen up, and we put God last. We put him on the back burner. Can I tell you something this morning? He will not take the back burner. Not at all. He has to be first. When you leave out the Lord Jesus Christ, you take a form of outer darkness, you in darkness. When you love the Lord Jesus Christ with all your heart, you come to the light. Anything less than that's darkness. When you don't follow Jesus and don't give a prophet and don't receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you get a prophet's reward. When you don't give a little one a cup of cool water in the name of Jesus Christ, you lose your reward. It's all about him. Amen. It's not about us. It's about him. Now, let me explain to you a little bit this morning. The reason I'm preaching like I'm preaching, because our days are getting short. Amen. Our windows of opportunity is closing down. Some of you are getting a little age on you. Amen. Amen. If you don't get this zeal and this fire and this repentance about toward loving the Lord Jesus, you're going to miss him. You're going to miss your rewards. You're going to miss your blessings. You're going to miss out on what you could have had. As I explained to you last Sunday morning, you won't find that message preached in many places. Because folks don't want to tell you that when you see the Lord Jesus, there might be some pain. You know, the health and wealth preachers today, they're doing mighty good. But you know what they're about? They're about you writing them checks so they can be prospered. Amen. Amen. It's not about that. It's not about writing a church or preacher a check so you can be prospered. It's about loving God. And when you love God, you're going to want to give to his work. Amen? Amen. It's about loving God. Now, let's go to the book of Ephesians. And not the book of Ephesians, but let's go to the book of Revelation and look at the church at Ephesus. And to cap this, I want us to go there. And you can see very clearly that the book of Ephesus is a book where people were doing all the right things. Matter of fact, they were really doing the things that God called them to do. Psalms 106 says, "Then believed his words, then sang his praise, but they soon forgot his works, and they waited not for his counsel, and they tempted God." Now, all of you that's been in supervision places before, when you had to talk to an employee about what he weren't doing right, you always told them some good things first, right? Kind of temper the blow, correct? Boy, you're good at these things and good at those things, but here's what we got to look at. You always tell them something good first. Well, if you notice when Jesus is talking to the churches in those, it was over 100 churches right after AD, right after Christ went back, right between the periods of 90 and 150 AD, 80, 60 and 110 AD after Christ. You'll notice something that there were hundreds of churches already established. Paul established a bunch of those, but Jesus picked seven churches out to represent the contemporary church. You know what contemporary means? It means what's the music of the day or what's the popular thing to do today. But those contemporary churches were seven churches that were established out of those hundreds of churches right after Pentecost. The book of Ephesus is a period between 30 A.D. and 300 A.D., and we call it a time of cooling off. What happened? People began to drift. They were doing a lot of good things. And it's typical today of modern religion. Ephesus was a city of about 225,000 people. And it had it had a temple in it where the goddess of Diana was.